And before we welcome our next speaker, Professor Prof Ming-chung Chu, will Professor Henry Tai, our Vice President of HKIS and the Director of HKUST Jockey Club Institute for Advanced Study, please introduce Professor Chu Chu to us.
Okay, the next speaker is Professor Chu Ming-chung from Chinese U of Hong Kong. He's a professor of physics there, and he's going to talk about the God particle. Ming-chung graduated from Caltech and stayed on for a PhD, and then I think he went to MIT and other places before coming back to Hong Kong with Chinese U in 1995. So he has been involved in the Daya Bay experiment, but he's not going to talk about that because our next speaker will talk about that. So Ming-chung is going to talk about the God particle and how Hong Kong at this moment is involved in studying God particle at the LHC at CERN. So let's thank Ming-chung.
Thank you. I'd like to first thank the organizers for inviting me here, giving me this opportunity to share with you what we have been doing in Hong Kong. So my plan is to first spend some time, just very briefly, explain to you what this so-called God particle is. I apologize in advance to the physicists in the audience that this will be extremely simplified, basically popular science level explanation. I'd like to discuss why this discovery 2 years ago, 2012, why it's so important. It basically opens up a new window. There will be a lot more exciting work on elementary particle physics that will come up. I will tell you then a little bit how people do this search, how they search for these new particles at the LHC. An exciting place to do science. And since a few months ago, there is now a Hong Kong team there. I'd like to also report to you what we have been doing and what our plan is. Okay, first of all, this has been reported widely. Even all the local Chinese newspapers have reported this so-called, the discovery of this so-called God particle. I'm going to tell you that all of these are wrong. But I'll explain why. Well, first of all, the standard model of particle physics. This is an amazingly successful model. It has been successful for more than 30 years. It tells us that everything in the universe, or the known matter, are made of elementary particles, the quarks and leptons. There are six kinds of quarks, six kinds of leptons. The electron is the most familiar form of the leptons. And there are four fundamental forces, strong force, weak force, electromagnetic force, and gravity, mediated by this so-called gauge bosons. So these bunch of particles form the elementary substance that make up of everything in the universe. So take an atom. There are the electrons on the outside, and then there's an atomic nucleus. If you break it up, you have the protons and neutrons, and inside there, we believe there are quarks. So the quarks are now the most fundamental level we know of, and the electrons outside. And so inside these protons or neutrons that most of us are made of, we have these quarks and gluons interacting wildly. Soup of quarks and gluons. Okay, there can be many questions that you'd like to ask about this picture of the universe. So have these elementary particles which seemingly have no structure. Well, of course, you would first soon notice that these particles come with masses. There's a large range of these masses. So for example, neutrinos, Ken Bill will tell you about. We don't even know what their masses are, but we believe that they are really tiny, on the order of less than 1 eV electron volt. Then if you look at the top quark, it goes up to 171 GeV. That's about 170 times the mass of a proton. So you wonder why these elementary particles, they have so different masses. What's the origin of all these masses? And then somehow, some of these gauge bosons, the photons and gluons, are massless. While others, like the Z and W bosons, which mediates the weak force, are much more massive. So these are questions that physicists would ask. And the so-called God particle is indeed a theory invented to try to address some of these questions. 1964, these three gentlemen, together with this list, a long list of names, worked out more or less independently the mechanism to give masses to some of these elementary particles, especially the gauge bosons, Z and W particles. Okay, we'll come back twice to this famous equation by Einstein, equals mc squared. So basically, at the simplest level, where are the mass from? They're from the energy. I mean, the interaction energy of these elementary particles. I'll use this equation again when I explain how they try to produce the Higgs boson using the same equation again. All right, at a very simple level, let me try to explain this so-called Higgs mechanism. Mass of the particle is basically given by the energy, and all kinds of energy will contribute to it, including interaction energy. So basically, the Higgs mechanism proposed that there's a medium which is hidden in the vacuum. So even though it looks like there's nothing in there, there is this Higgs field. There's a field of something hidden in the vacuum, and it acts as if it's a medium, so that when the elementary particles travel through it, they interact with this medium and acquire the mass. Okay? So the interaction energy becomes the mass of these particles. There are lots of analogies in, for example, condensed matter system. If you have an electron moving in a crystal, it will feel the interaction energy with this medium, and then the electron would acquire some effective mass. It's many times larger than its mass in vacuum. And this is basically the same picture that the Higgs mechanism would let the elementary particles have masses. And the different particles have different interactions with this medium, and that's why they have so different masses. Now, to show that such a picture works, one way to do it, so even though this Higgs field is hidden in a vacuum, you could try to excite it. If you can find excited states of this Higgs field, then that would be an indirect evidence for its existence. So the excited states of this Higgs field is what we call the Higgs particle. Physicists don't like to call it the God particle, but somehow it's too popular, so I have to use the name God's particle. So this is an animation to show this picture. In vacuum, all these elementary particles are massless. But because the vacuum is full of this Higgs field, which acts like a medium, so that when the elementary particles travel through it, they acquire some masses. Those particles, such as the top quarks, if they interact strongly with this medium, with this Higgs field, then they would acquire large mass. But other particles, like the photon, which doesn't interact with this Higgs field, so they remain massless. Okay. Why is this 212 discovery so important? If you list reasons. Well, first of all, of course, they have found a new elementary particles, and it's actually the first scalar particle, the list of elementary particles. It actually behaves very much like the scalar particle predicted by the Higgs theory. So we always say it's Higgs-like particle. If it indeed is a Higgs boson, then it confirms the Higgs mechanism and confirms the standard model. It confirms the cage theory approach to interaction, which was, of course, pioneered by Cian Yang. It confirms how we unified electroweak interactions, and then that, of course, gives us a lot of confidence to move on to unify all other forces, the grand unification. But perhaps even more importantly, the discovery of this God particle, or this Higgs field, means that there will be a new fundamental force. Not just the four, not just the electromagnetic, gravity, and strong forces, but now we have a new kind of force, the Higgs interacting with all these different particles, and we don't quite know how this force would act, what its properties are. So for the coming years, a lot of the activities would be concentrated on studying this Higgs particle, Higgs mechanism, the details of it, and to really understand this new fundamental force. So now there are not four fundamental forces in nature, five, maybe even more. If this turns out to be not the Higgs particle in the standard model, that would be even more exciting. Even if you don't care about all this grand unification and so on, I think it's, for human beings, it's important to understand that, understand the origin of masses. If indeed this Higgs particle gives masses to elementary particles, such as electron, then that's a big step in our conceptual understanding of nature, because the mass of electron actually determines the sizes of atoms. So our sizes are determined by the mass of electron, and that's given by the Higgs field. So in this sense, it might be somewhat related to God particle. But I promise that all these reports in the newspapers are wrong, and I would explain it, right? Why are they wrong? Because the Higgs field is not the origin of all masses. It might be the origin of the electron's mass, but definitely not the mass of the proton. Your mass, in the end, is mostly coming from protons and neutrons. For example, if you take a proton, it has a mass about 1 GeV. The quarks and gluons inside are very, very light. Basically, you can ignore their masses, and then you can ask, where's the mass of a proton or neutron? The answer is that a lot of it comes from the kinetic energy of the quarks and gluons, and then some of it was stored in the potential energy of this strong interaction. So the gluons and quarks are strongly interacting, and this potential energy contributes a lot to the total mass. So don't believe in all these reports. Usually, the reporters don't know enough physics to write the articles, fortunately. Okay, let me now tell you about the Large Hadron Collider and how they search for the Higgs particle. Large Hadron Collider is the largest, the most powerful accelerator in the world, located at CERN in Switzerland, right next to France. There's a ring for this accelerator, 27 kilometers in perimeter. It accelerates protons up to very close to the speed of light, Up to last year, the energy per proton was about 8 TeV. It's now being shut down. When it runs again next year, it will start with 13 or 14 TeV. So this will be an unprecedentedly high energy. We are all very excited about next year. So just a brief animation to show you how the LHC runs. So there are several stages of accelerating the protons, making use of old accelerators at CERN. And finally, they boost it up to 70 EV, that's 2012. And then they will collide these beams of protons. This is an imaginary view of the underground tunnels. If you think of the protons as making up of quarks and gluons, and when they collide, you break it up, and you create all sorts of particles. The brief moments when they collide and releases a lot of energy, this energy will then create all sorts of particles. Hopefully, some of these energies will be used to create massive particles that we have not discovered yet. For example, this is an event of a Higgs particle which lives free for a very short moment and then decay into other particles. Why do we do high energy collisions? For several reasons. One, to recreate this Big Bang. Professor Low already showed you this picture. We believe that about 13.8 billion years ago, the universe was hot, very, very hot. So we want to recreate that high temperature, high energy density conditions in the lab. Another reason is to probe deeper into the structure of matter. High energy, the smaller length scale you look into. Third reason is what I just mentioned. If we hope to provide enough energy to create massive but hidden particles that we have not discovered yet, such as the Higgs particle or maybe the dark matter. So high energy lets us look further back in time. It also lets us look deeper in space. We have joined the ATLAS experiments at LHC. The detector is located on one location along this LHC ring. The detector is hidden about 100 meters underground. This is a real picture of this detector. It's a huge detector, 44 meter by 25 meter. Its weight is about the same as Eiffel Tower. This is the size of a human being. This is what it looks like. Give you a better feeling for this size. We're in this building. What if I put the ATLAS detector here? It's actually a little bit thinner, but much taller by about one third. Imagine turning this whole building into a particle detector. That would be a crazy dream, I guess. Right, so a particle detector basically just measures the momenta and energy of all the particles created in this collision. And then, of course, imagine that we record all this information, process them, maybe millions of channels of all these detectors, all combining, recreating what happened at the collision. That's the main job of experimental physicists working at LHC. The ATLAS collaboration is a huge collaboration. About 3,000 scientists from 39 countries or regions, 177 institutions. These numbers, and then you have to add three institutions in June 14th. CUHK, HKU, HKUST, we join as one team. Okay, how do they search for Higgs? Well, imagine finding a needle in a haystack. That's way too easy. A better analogy is to look for a bit of hay in a haystack. Let me explain why there's this saying. Okay, so we collide protons and release a lot of energy, and hopefully this energy would excite this mysterious Higgs field hidden in the vacuum. That's the idea. So the cartoon is like this. So we collide the protons, create a small bang, and disrupt the vacuum. So this wave is supposed to represent the excited state of the Higgs field or the Higgs particle. But the Higgs particle only lives for a very short time. It will decay very rapidly into other particles. In the end, all you see are the final products, like the electrons and positrons. So, collide protons, maybe we create the Higgs. It decays into other particles. In the end, all we detect are these electrons, positrons, and so on. We can only detect the decay product of Higgs particles. However, there are many other processes not related to Higgs that produce the same signals. These are our background events. And we got many, many more background events than Higgs signal. I'll show you the number. It's really amazing. So the trick is to find the real signals from this huge background. So this is why we say it's more or less like finding a small bit of hay in a haystack. We have to do this. Okay? We found the Higgs. All right, now, so what does the Higgs particle decay to? Okay? It could decay into two photons, into four leptons, some quarks, and so on. Let me be very brief now to skip this even. So our detector would measure all the energies and momenta of all the final state products, all the electrons, everything. And then we calculate the total energy momenta of all these products. Technically, we calculate the total invariant mass. If the particles are created by these decay products of Higgs, then they would the events would all come from the same invariant mass. Whereas the background events come from all sorts of processes, and they will give you different kinds of energy. So there will be a smooth background, but there will be a small bump at the invariant mass corresponding to the mass of the Higgs. So that's the basic idea how we search for the Higgs bump. 212, they release the results, and you see this very small bump here at 125 GeV. In mass, in very mass. This is Higgs decaying to four leptons, so electrons and muons and so on. And they find this small bump on top of some smooth background. I'll show you the number, how difficult it was. There were only 21 events in this bump, corresponding to the Higgs decay. Out of 1,000 trillion collisions. So most of these collisions create just backgrounds, these smooth backgrounds. And we only found 21 events that correspond to a Higgs decay. Another example, this is combining all the subchannels. Also, Higgs going to four leptons. Only 13 events out of 1,000 trillion collisions. But all the analysis were done very carefully with two groups independently, And in fact, the two experiments, HKUST and CMS, have different subgroups, and they do all kinds of cross-checks to make sure that they have enough confidence in this discovery. This shows you the accumulation of data and the statistical significance of the hex is really rising up when you get enough data. This region. The red shows you the known background. So we calculate the known background to all kinds of details, understand the background to very good precision. The data shows you this excess, which agrees very well with the Higgs model. Okay. So in the last 2 years, the experimentalists have continued to work to try to understand how this Higgs particle coupled to different particles. So now we can compare the signal strength in different channels with the prediction by the standard model. The error bars are still large, so it's not very conclusive yet whether this is a standard model Higgs particle or not. This is ongoing work, which just show you some favor. Okay, let me now switch to the Hong Kong team. Okay, so we have joined in June. We've become a regular member now. We're supported by RGC Collaborative Research Fund. The three universities joined as one team. In fact, even before we joined ATLAS, we have been sending 2 to 4 undergraduates every summer to CERN since 2011. And right now, if you go to CERN, we already have a team there, and we have 1 postdoc, 2 PhDs, 4 MPhils working on the projects, 4 faculty members. I'll just show you some faces. Always nice to see young faces, not old faces. So this is the ATLAS detector that we're in. This is a famous landmark at CERN. This is actually a science museum. It shows you that shows you how serious they are in education as well. Okay, what's our plan? Okay, we have already formed a joint center for fundamental physics, CHK, HKU, HKUST. So not just particle experimentalists. We also put together particle theorists, astrophysicists, and we interact so that we enhance each other's efforts. We like to participate in the upgrade of the HKUST detector, including hardware upgrade and software simulations and so on. We are already taking up data analysis of the previous run, and we hope to be ready for the next run starting April 2015, when the energy and beam intensities will be roughly doubled. And furthermore, we have developed collaborations with our engineering colleagues, including, skip all these technical terms, including computing and electronics work. Now, a lot of people talk about big data today. CERN is really the big data center. The LHC collisions generate 25 petabytes of data every year. And these data will be shipped around the world for all kinds of processing. And in fact, grid computing was developed at CERN, as well as the internet itself was developed just so that all these scientists from many different countries can work together. This is an amazing project in terms of computing and big data, basically. So we have lined up with computer scientists at both CHK and UST here to work on some of these scientific computing projects. We are also working on the electronics. So the data acquisition at electronics is a huge challenge. So it involves also some IC design and testing. So we are working with our engineering colleagues as well as a team at ASTRI, the Applied Science and Technology Research Institute in Science Park. I think the Hong Kong team does have some strength here. by aligning ourselves with our engineering colleagues and even S3. It's the right place and right time to be at, especially since they are going to switch on the collider again next year, double the energy. A lot of potential for new discoveries. There might be other Higgs, there might be even stranger particles and so on. And there's also some serious discussion of building the next collider in China. So I hope that our efforts will put Hong Kong on the map. That discussion. Then finally, just 2 weeks ago, I showed some government officials from Hong Kong. They came to CERN to take a visit, and also two representatives from Science Museum. They will in fact host an exhibition next year about LHC and CERN. We're working together with them. And we hope that, other than doing fundamental physics research, we also take this opportunity to promote science education. All I'd like to say, thank you.
So, any questions from the floor?
You mentioned that if this Higgs-like particle discovery in this 125 GeV is indeed verified as a Higgs, and that, of course, is very exciting. It provides opportunity to look for many other things in the standard model. But one thing you feel very interesting is that if it turned out to be not, this Higgs, so-called Higgs-like is not a real Higgs particle, as in the original theory, that it would be even more exciting. Now, I would like to say, what are these excitements? Can you outline them?
Yeah, there's this interesting psychology in science. I heard this story from a friend of mine who worked on gravitational wave. Okay, there's this big gravitational wave detector in the US, the LIGO. They got a huge funding. And I heard that originally when they asked for funding, selling point is that they didn't even know what they would find. So there's always this excitement that if you find something that we did not even expect in all the theories, that's even better. If you only confirm some theories, that's good, but that's not so exciting. Right? I think that's why during lunch we were talking about the 2 years ago, there was this infamous experiment about neutrino speed being faster than light. Everybody was excited. Even the security guard in our office building would ask me, what happened to the neutrinos? Everybody get excited. And in fact, ironically, you get even more public support when that happened. But even in the scientific level, I think a lot of us would be amazed if this 1964 model, the simplest form of model, would work. That would be way too lucky. So I think a lot of people would feel that probably the main idea worked, but the details are not, and then there might be more than one hex, there might be different kinds of interactions. Just finding out all these details, understanding this new force, fundamental force, I think that's already very exciting. To ask me whether there's any protection of this CERN from terrorist attack.
Yeah, can I just ask if the collider is underground?
Yes.
So does it create, because if you have particles moving at such a great speed, does it create any field that might be hazardous to human health?
Yes, the radiation, when they run the collisions, nobody is allowed into the tunnel. But the entire ring is 100 meters below ground. So on surface, it is safe. Yes, yes, they monitor that very carefully.
So you said there's a team of like 10 people I saw. Most of them are students. What do they do? What kind of work do they participate?
Right.
The day is wrong, obviously.
Okay.
November 27th?
Oh, sorry.
It's October, right? October.
Okay, let me show you the students. So there are undergraduates, they're participating in the summer research program. So they take up different kinds of projects. My PhD student is working on a HEX-CP search, which really just means to see whether the HEX interaction produce some asymmetry that might even account for why we only have matter and not antimatter. It's a very technical field, but in principle, nobody knows. So Haonan is looking for CP violations in the HEX sector, basically. My MPhil student, Kaming, worked on reconstruction. So we have all these muons coming out. We want to reconstruct, get the tracks, reconstruct where they happen. He worked on that software, basically. There's a new MPhil student at Hong Kong U. The plan is for him to look for supersymmetric particles.
Working on their own, or are they part of a huge team, or do they live there, and how does that work?
Right, right.
Do they still go to class?
Yeah, take Haonan, he just came back from CERN after staying there for 5 months. So he has to come here, he will take classes during regular semester. He'll go there in May, right after class, and stay there. This time, because the HCP work is finishing, so he stayed one extra month. So this term, he's not taking any classes, but they'll make up for it next semester. MPhil students have to come back during the semester, but they'll stay there for 4 months. When they are there, they work with members of our group. So for example, Lewis is an assistant professor at CUHK. Kirill is a research assistant professor at UST. So they are really supervising all these students. I go there too, during some time in the summer. As part of the HEX group, so the HEX group, there are actually 5 different subgroups, even just within ATLAS. And we are members of one of these groups. And all this simulation and muon reconstruction work, they belong to some other groups. So in a way, we are within one group of a bigger group, of an even bigger group within ATLAS. And then everybody basically also work with different subgroups. It's complicated how these 3,000 people work together. But I thought this is a really invaluable opportunity for the students. Yes, Kirill is a convener of one of the HEX groups. We are already occupying something very important.
These students, what's their expectation? Let's say after they get their degrees and so on. So they're going to, there's only one LHC, which is in Switzerland. Although I heard, right, China is trying to build something. Are they thinking about being an academic, being a professor, or work in some big research lab? What are they thinking? Or they're just interested in science and they just don't think about that?
I think most of them just like to work on this. They don't really think too much, honestly speaking. I've been telling them honestly that all this software skill, hardware skills they acquire, the experience of working in a high-profile project, interacting with top experts from so many different countries, they really need to worry. I think they believe me. But also, I told them that there are lots of opportunities in Asia, in China, which I truly believe that's true.
Okay, I think we can save the discussion in the tea break time. So thank you, Professor Chu. Yep.